Hi, I'm Pastor James Travis. This is our Organ Bench Devotion on Stand Up for Jesus. We're going to look at two questions in this devotion today. First of all, what should we stand up for? And then secondly, can we stand up and still remain with a good reputation? So with that, let's take a look at our hymn for tonight.
Stand up, stand up.
The hymn Stand Up for Jesus by George Duffield, and Robert Morgan writes a lot about him. It really starts back, this hymn Stand Up with Jesus, not with Duffield himself, but with Dudley Tang, who served as his father's assistant in the Philadelphia Church of the Epiphany. And when he retired, he became the pastor there. And you can imagine, there's a honeymoon when you start as a pastor and everybody likes you. But then soon he found him preaching against slavery. He was standing up for those that were being oppressed. And there were loud complaints until he resigned from being a pastor. So should we be standing up against slavery? That's a question that we might ask. Should we be standing up against abortion? Should we be standing against homosexuality? Should we be standing against gossip? Against the abuse of the rights of immigrants? What should we be standing up for? This is a question that comes. Well, long story short, he started preaching in the YMCA. And he really stood up for men at that time. At one time, over 1,000 men were converted in one night. Let me read you what Robert Morgan writes about after that great event. It says, 2 weeks later, Dudley was visiting the countryside, watching a corn thresher in the barn. His hand moved too close to the machine, and his sleeve was snared. His arm was ripped from his socket, the main artery severed. 4 days later, his right arm was amputated close to the shoulder. When it appeared he was dying, Dudley told his aged father, "Stand up for Jesus, Father, and tell my brethren of the ministry to stand up for Jesus." Well, Pastor Duffield of Philadelphia's Temple Presbyterian Church was deeply stirred by Dudley's funeral. And the following Sunday, he preached from Ephesians 6:14, which says, "Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness." And then he read a poem that he had written, inspired by Dudley's words. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. So that first question, what should we stand up for? Well, first and foremost, it's for Jesus. We're called to stand even to the death rather than fall away from him. You might think of people like Daniel, who would rather go to the lion's den than deny that he believed in his Lord. Or you might think of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego that were willing to go to the fiery furnace. We stand up for Jesus, that others would know that he is real in our life and that we are going to pray to him. We're going to worship him no matter what. We're going to stand up. But what about other issues? What should we stand up for? The scripture has some things to say about what we should stand up for. And I want to read first from Psalm 82:3, which says, "Defend the weak and the fatherless. Uphold the cause of the poor and the oppressed." In other words, people that can't stand up for themselves, as we follow Jesus, we stand up for them as well. Somebody that's poor, the rich can bring them down. And so we want to stand up and say, hey, they need to eat too. They need to be provided for as well. In fact, the Bible commands that a farmer, a rich farmer, shouldn't cultivate and harvest the entire field. He should leave the corners unharvested so that the poor can go in and pick some of the grain and so live. That was kind of their welfare program at that time. And I find it interesting that their welfare program involved the poor actually having to work, which is interesting. But it's standing up for those that can't provide for themselves. James says, religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their affliction and then keep oneself unstained from the world. So definitely in the Bible we're called to stand up for the orphans, those that don't have a father and mother who might be thrown into slavery. And in our today's world, we might even think of those that are unborn, that we want to stand up for them and build them up. But I think one thing that is absolutely wrong is to stand up for them and then when they're born, abandon them. That would be sinful. You want to stay and build them up. I remember back when I was in seminary, they would go to Planned Parenthood, many of the seminarians, and I learned a great lesson there that some of our leaders, they would go and stand against abortion, but then they would, when a woman questioned whether she should have it or not, they would actually give money and then stay alongside them for the long haul. And I know our own Her Health Women's Center does that. They don't just stand against abortion, but they stand with young women and young men and with these babies to make sure that they're cared for and provided, and they give cribs and diapers and training, and it's easy to stand up with words, but what I'm saying is when we stand up for something, we stand with actions and care and love, not just the baby, but the mom and the dad as well. So we stand up for those around us. And the same way with those, the foreigner. Often the foreigner doesn't know the language of the land. And so the Bible talks about showing compassion to them as well and providing. A number of years ago, I was down in Garden City in Florida. And there was a big predicament going on. You've got all these illegal aliens in our country. So we know in the Bible we're to care for them. So we made sure they had food and provision. But on the other hand, we know they were there illegally. And so the other goal as Christians is to follow the government. And so we urged them and the organization itself helped them to go do things rightly and legally and become citizens. So there's both sides of that. The second question I came up with, how do we maintain a good reputation? Well, the Bible says, live such good lives among the pagans or the unbelievers that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day He visits us. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human authority, whether to the emperor as to the supreme authority or to governors, who are sent by Him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will that by doing good, you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish people. Now, you'll notice what everything that is talked about here is about actions. Often in this political environment we find ourselves in, people hurt each other. They don't listen to one another. So, for example, when I talk about abortion, yeah, it's wrong. But at the same time, I want to talk about and listen to the one who's had an abortion and let them know that Jesus died on the cross to forgive their sins. And likewise, I'm just as great a sinner as the person that has an abortion. And so Jesus died for me as well, just as well to you. See, we're sinners confronting sinners. So we have to be very, very careful to show compassionate with each other. In sexuality, when we deal with sexual issues, those outside the church don't understand God's purposes. And obviously, as a church member, we stand up for one man, one woman in marriage. But on the other hand, those out in the world, they could care less about what we believe. And so we're going to care and love those outside in the world, even if they live lives that we completely disagree with. Now, if they learn about Jesus and want to have his new lifestyle, obviously, we're going to stand up for the faith. As you become a Christian, certain sexualities are not right in God's eyes. But here's the thing. All of us have sinned. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Our sins kill Jesus, but thank God he did die because he takes our sins away. So we stand up for Jesus. Let me read that verse again. Stand up for Jesus, you soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner. It must not suffer loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall he lead, till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. So we want to live good lives, so that even people that disagree with us would go, yeah, they care about people they even disagree with. They love those and care for those that are practicing homosexuality, and they feed them and bring clothing and shoes to them. What is up with that? They don't even believe in that, and they care for them anyway. And they actually listen to the authorities and follow what they say. Maybe it's worth becoming a Christian. There's something there. For it is God's will that by doing good, you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish people. You see how this works? Yeah, we stand up for the issues. And most importantly, we stand up for Jesus, and there's no compromising there. But on the other hand, when it comes to all these social issues, which God does want us to care for the unborn, the widow, the foreigner, the orphan, and even to stand up for those that are poor. And there's a lot of political environment that would say, I don't know about that. But we want to silence so that everybody says, wow, following Jesus, that's worth doing. I hope that you'll stand with Jesus.